hitch up to remote Sylvania. I sit back and act like nothing ever stranger. But I keep knocking and you keep ignoring me. And I wonder if you're ever gonna answer when your life, your wife is riddled now with cancer. But I'm not a traveling salesman, no, I'm not the Kirby man. I'm not here to fix your cable, and I don't work for Uncle Sam. I'm not a Jehovah's Witness, a Mormon missionary. I'm not here to ask if you're able. Could you help me, please? I came because my father sent me.
I grew up Methodist, but for a very short time I was Baptist. I lived in Clayton, and my father-in-law was a Southern Baptist minister and a very good preacher. He loved John Wesley, and we talked more about who Christ was than we ever talked about denominations. And that's who I think of when I think of a pastor that really focuses on the story of Jesus to be told and not our own story. Billy Graham was very surprised that Dr. Wacker would want to come and interview him and write a book about his life, because for Billy Graham, he was just a mouthpiece for God. So don't miss that part of today's conversation with Dr. Wacker. Don't get caught up in denomination or theology. Get focused on this beautiful story that God has to tell, and not just one way that God has to tell it, but all of the ways that we can listen. I'm grateful that you're here this morning. Welcome to White Plains.
Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back. No turning back. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
So we're going to do something a little different as we go to our time of prayer today. We're actually going to have a conversation. And I'm dressed like this in a little bit more formal way because we're here in the sanctuary. And I want to introduce you to Al and Lois, who are with us, and Dr. Lee and Ray are here too. And we were all gathered like this and dressed up like this just a little bit before Christmas, right? When we welcomed Al and Lois into membership. Tell us just a little bit, what was it, Al, that brought y'all to White Plains? How did you come to be?
Well, we had moved here 2 years ago, right after COVID started, into Cary, and started looking for churches and did some searching, and eventually found your church, White Plains, online, because that was the only choices we were having. And we were watching about three or four different services sometimes. Mm-hmm. And then at some point, we actually came to the church here, and we felt a very warm feeling. And a warm feeling was probably the result of lots of things, but even just the architecture and the wood structure, and then the whole environment, the music and the preaching, just gave us a feeling that it was a warm community here, and the parishioners here welcomed us quite readily. And then I think secondly, it was the people, the pastors, the interaction that we had with them immediately, and the congregation itself. And I suppose there's probably a third factor in this. Somehow guiding all of this was probably the Holy Spirit. Mm. And so those three components were very big, and I separate them, but in a sense, they're all integrated.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit and the church at large, as well as the people in it.
Well, I'm really glad when you brought the Holy Spirit into it, because I do believe that the Holy Spirit weaves in and among us and bonds us in community. And one of our purposes for sharing this with folks is that, you know, we don't just want to be a church that preaches on Sunday mornings or Friday night or whenever people watch us online, or even if they come in person. We don't just want to be a place where someone comes in and sits in a pew for, you know, an hour or hour and a half of phrase preaching, you know. and to be involved and connected in a small group, right? Would you be willing to pray for us and to pray for Al and Lois?
I will start, but really, will you finish?
Yes, sir.
Would that work for you?
It works.
All right. Let's pray, shall we? God, we thank you for this wonderful duet, that they come to us as disciples who understand this is God's doing. Lord, I pray for them that you continue to reveal to them what it is that you're doing in and through them as they teach and help us understand who we are called to be. And likewise, Lord, let us be a people who breathe life and support and mercy and grace into them. Mm-hmm. So that, Lord, as we travel through our lives together, the rivers of life, that there's always a place to stop and refuel and support and care for one another, Lord. That's what we hope and dream for them and for ourselves. So let it be, Lord, just that, a place to replenish and re-nourish, so we can set off another journey to share this good news of the Christ we serve.
Lord, we give you thanks for the way you created us to be in relationship with you and with each other. And as now we have this opportunity for new relationships, for new learnings that come as you reveal yourself through Lois and through Al, and we can learn understandings of you, ourselves, and of them that help us to grow to be more like you. What a gift that is. What a privilege. Let it be joy. Let it be filled with hope. But above all, help us to all be faithful in following you and following your leading through the power of the Holy Spirit. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 We hear lots of times about bearing fruit. What does that really mean? I think what it means is that point that we were making about it's just what we do. After developing the language of faith, we're different people, and what we do changes. But there's fruit that is more like Christ, that's of the Holy Spirit living in us. Let's learn in the next two passages a little bit about what that looks like to live. John tells us, and this is Jesus speaking, "You didn't choose me, remember, I chose you and put you in the world to bear fruit, fruit that won't spoil. As fruit bearers, whatever you ask the Father in relation to me, he gives you. But remember," and here's that theme again, "but remember the root command, love one another." But what does the fruit look like? Paul describes it in his letter to the Galatians. He tells them first what isn't the fruit. And it's one fruit. It's really who the kind of actions or responses we make with each other and what it looks like. And he says, "I can tell you the things that are of this world are not like that." You know, that's going to be strife and jealousy and anger and quarrels. It's going to be envy. It might be drunkenness or some kind of carousing. Eugene Peterson even says that it's an accumulation of mental and emotional garbage. It's frenzied. It's joyless. It is competitive. It has an all-consuming drive for stuff, for things. Divided homes, divided communities, divided families. But Paul goes on to say, by contrast, the fruit of the Spirit, and these attributes are all combined. It's not, I don't pick out which ones that feel easier to me. It's all of them together in one package. Listen to what they look like. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There's no law against such things as these.
Thank you.
another characteristic to think about, in addition to what we do, is who we are. Paul's trying to help the folks have an understanding that who we genuinely are makes a difference. Anyone who joined in Christ is a new being. The old is gone. The new has come. All this is done by God, who through Christ changed us from enemies into his friends and gave us the task of making others his friends too.
There's nobody like God.
Welcome back, folks, and welcome to worship. I'm Ray, one of the pastors here at White Plains. And last week, we started talking with this guy beside me, Dr. Grant Wacker. And Grant, as I mentioned last week, is our country, particularly, and the world for that matter, one of the American Christian historians that there is. I mean, he is the dude. And so we're grateful to have him, and I'm grateful for his friendship and his wife, Catherine. Now, some of you at White Plains might have been here a couple of years ago when we had Grant for an evening with one of his books. And he has spent a particular amount of time and energies and resources on a man who all of us will know, or at least know of, and it is just really intriguing, and I want to get in a moment why this particular person. But Grant has written two books on Billy Graham. And one of them was entitled America's Pastor. That was your first one,
right?
Which I thought was intriguing what your father-in-law said about that one.
It was my stepfather, who is a long-retired electrician. And so I sent him a copy, and a couple weeks later, he wrote back, and he said, thanks for the book. He said, I'm halfway through the introduction, no relief in sight.
But go out and buy the book anyway.
Yeah.
But
I admit, that one was heavy going.
It's an academic.
Academic.
It's a sociological, yeah. Right. Academic, and Christian history of this man. If you don't want to just really a hard read, get your second book, and that is, it reads like a novel. It really does. I mean, he's a gifted writer. I'm going to brag on him there, too. It reads like a novel. You were able, in that book, you read a lot of firsthand documents.
I did.
Mm-hmm. Tons of those. Mm-hmm. Billy was still living then. Mm-hmm. And so you kind of have carte blanche to...
Well, what I found most both intriguing and instructive about life and about the faith are the letters that people wrote to him. And over the years, literally millions. That's hard to believe, though it's true of, you know, Oprah and other celebrities in that sense, that people just pour out their hearts. And so millions came in to the office. Only a small number have survived. They just didn't have room.
Didn't have room, right.
And for reasons of confidentiality. Mm-hmm. So millions came in. They have kept several thousand over the years. And so I read a large number of those, just a sampling. And couldn't even begin to read all of the ones they've kept.
Right.
But I took them as a direct window into American culture and into Christian faith. It was so illuminating, often very touching. And my wife was with me for a lot of those research sessions, many of those hours. And at one point, her eyes just welled up with tears. She said, "I can't do this anymore."
Oh, wow.
It's all I can do.
Is that moving?
Yeah, because people would share their lives, and often things that were funny, things they were happy about, and then the things they were sad about.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's one thing we learned, there's a lot of suffering out there.
Yeah, yeah.
And Graham touched that. He touched the suffering. He also had a lot to do with their joys. They're coming to faith, or I think, I wouldn't say more often, but very often, to rediscovering a faith that had been lost.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And over they would say, "Well, you know, I grew up a Christian, and then I went off to college, or I went in the military, and I strayed, and, you know, this or that happened, and then you came back to town, and I went to one of your meetings, just out of curiosity, and then I remembered. I remembered what it was all about in the first place. Wow. And I came back to the church. I came back to Christ. I came back to faith." That's very moving to me.
It is moving.
In a sense, the reconversions or the reattachments to what they had known but lost.
If you could write Billy Graham, it's kind of like writing the White House. If you just put Billy Graham, it was going to get to him.
Yeah, although he wouldn't see it himself.
I mean, yeah, I know that.
Coming
yeah,
in,
as many people,
but it would get to
you
him.
You didn't have to necessarily put an address there.
No, actually, yeah. I mean, one of the things the organization has done is archive many of the envelopes.
Oh.
And this is telling in itself, often very funny.
Yeah.
One that I like, many of them funny, but the one especially memorable is it had a full address, Billy Graham, and then the street address in Minneapolis, and Minneapolis, Minnesota, zip code, everything. But down in the lower left-hand corner, in little letters, it said, "In case of rapture, never mind."
Isn't that great?
Yeah. But there were envelopes there that simply said Billy Graham. And it's like, you know, Santa Claus, you know. And the post office knew where to go. And, you know, except for political figures like the President of the United States, I think there would be extremely few people with just their name.
And gets to where it's supposed
and,
to be.
And it would get there. Right? And some would say, you know, Billy Graham, world. Which is pretty wide there.
Yeah.
And or United States, and or say somewhere in Minnesota.
I mean, somewhere in Minnesota.
Yeah,
that's a lot of land.
It would get there. Yeah. So
I want to ask you, what was the igniting of your interest in this man?
I wanted to write about something that would be personally meaningful. I did not want to write about simply some academic topic, and I certainly didn't want to write about someone whose life I found unhelpful or despicable or something like that. Now, we need books about people like that.
Sure.
But I didn't want to be the one to do it.
Yeah.
I didn't, you know. And so I wanted to write about someone whose life I thought would help me understand my life and my faith.
I don't know if you know, Billy Graham was Baptist.
Really?
Yeah, he was.
You
missed that, didn't you?
Yeah, why didn't you tell me that when you were my pastor?
You would assume you would know.
Yeah,
but
anyway,
but a United Methodist,
yeah.
Thinking about how how might this guy feed my soul, for lack of a better term?
Actually, I'll pick up on that first, in that we were joking about it. He grew up a very conservative Presbyterian, Associate Reformed Presbyterian Church. But actually, what was really fascinating to me about Billy is that he was always Southern Baptist. He never fudged on that, but he never let that define his ministry. He always wanted to speak beyond the Southern Baptist Convention, and he did.
And he did. Oh, well, there's no doubt.
So he did actually speak to the Southern Baptist Convention, but that was comparatively a very small part of what he wanted to do. Mm-hmm. He always wanted to be speaking to a much larger audience. And the key there, I think, is not because he was reluctant or ashamed to be Baptist, but that he was called to speak beyond the local Baptist church.
Probably, I mean, he was, as you've said in a conversation before, he was a very astute CEO. He probably knew to do that would have limited.
He knew where his calling was. He was very clear about his calling in a strong sense, and he was offered over the year. People urged him to run for U.S. Senate from North Carolina, and he admitted that at one point he considered it. And so then his wife told him that he could never win, and he said, "Why?" And she said, "Because the American people would never vote for a divorced man." She had a sense of humor. We often think of Billy as very conservative, and actually he wasn't. And
no.
As he grew older, he became much less so, and I don't know if you call him liberal or not, but I mean, actually as he grew older, he tried to transcend partisan politics.
Yes. But my gut is he learned a lot of that through Nixon, that you can't do that.
In some ways, Nixon was the best thing that ever happened to Billy.
Yeah.
Because Billy was burned by his unfortunate relationship with Nixon. Yeah. And after the Watergate situation, Billy, he regretted it and said, "I'm mortified looking at how I got entangled." And afterwards, he often said that. He said, "I allowed that personal friendship to cloud my judgment, and I should have understood that." But more than that, he said, the bigger issue is that I got sucked into partisan politics, and the gospel is bigger. Well, he said two things. Politics has no business in the pulpit. And he understood that there is a line. It's a blurred line.
There may
line.
Be a moral line at some
moral
point.
Moral line, racial justice, is that politics? No.
No.
But he understood that you can't always tell exactly, where the line is. But his example was American policy about the Panama Canal. He said, "This is not a great moral question.
No.
It's a pragmatic, public policy question."
Oh, that's right.
"And I'm not going to, stake my life on that." But when you get into the partisan stuff, that doesn't belong in the pulpit. But the other thing he did say is that he said, "I don't think the moral majority spends enough time dealing with questions of poverty and suffering." He did.
Gut is he was more focused on what is the church called to be and to do.
Right, yeah. Anyway, that's what drew me to Billy. And so what did I see in him that informs my life today positively? One of the privileges of my life in working on the project is I got to see him four times.
Personally,
and he was getting on in years. And so anyway, the first time that we saw him, he was on in years, and so he with some difficulty he struggled to get up, and he took her hand first, not mine. He took her hand and greeted her. And then his assistant, who was there, said, "Now, Billy Grant is writing a book about you." And he said, "Why?" Now, that took me back. I wasn't expecting that question at all.
How in the world did you answer that?
Well, I was...
I'd have been bumbling.
I was flummoxed for a moment. And so then I said, "Well, you've done important things." And he instantly said, "No," he said, "the Lord has done important things through me."
And my guess is that wasn't fluff. He believed that.
And what I think is really significant there, he didn't deny he'd done important things. No. He didn't say, you know, a lot of us would say, oh, shucks, I never really done. Yeah. He didn't say that at all. He knew perfectly well who he was. He knew the power of his voice.
Yeah.
All right. So he didn't deny that. But what he instantly did was give credit for it to the source.
So he switched the focus.
And I think it was genuine.
Yeah.
One of the key words in the Bible is communion, from which we get our word communication. Jesus came to a man one time that was lonely and sick and paralyzed. 38 years he'd sat in the same spot, lonely and tired, without a friend. And Jesus looked at him and said, do you need a friend? And he said, yes. This bundle of loneliness and human pain had been buffeted by the surging tides of thousands of people. But Jesus singled him out. He became his friend that day and he healed him. He can become your friend tonight if you'll let him. Loneliness began actually in the Garden of Eden, in a perfect paradise, when man and woman declared their independence of God. They said, we don't need you, God. We can build this world without you. So they made a terrible choice. They chose to turn away from God. They went their own way, tried to build their world, and sin entered at that beautiful garden. And it was given to the next generation, down to you and me. And we all have the disease, and it's a fatal disease. Because you see, in that garden, God went looking for Adam. He knew where he was, but he went looking for him. He wanted Adam to know where he was. He said, Adam, where are you? And Adam tried to hide, got some fig leaves and sewed them on. He didn't know he was naked till then. But he couldn't hide. Loneliness has never been a respecter of persons. The world's greatest artists, writers and composers, kings and queens and carpenters and plumbers and everybody have felt this terrible thing called loneliness. There was a time when you felt you meant business with God, but now your heart has grown cold and hard towards spiritual things. You've been pulled away by others and other things and other gods and other pleasures that you know to be wrong. And you went out from the presence of God and you have found that it's night out there. Sin makes us lonely, because it separates us from God. And it was never in God's intention for you to be lonely. Hundreds of surveys prove that our society has not made us a better adjusted or happier society. Oh yes, we can have fleeting moments of sensual satisfaction, creates a bitterness and a loss of sense of pleasure that no psychiatrist can cure. He offers you a new life. He offers you peace and joy and friendship. Never to be lonely again.
Understood. It was a decision of heart and head.
It was
absolutely
and hands.
Yes,
right. Of heart and head and hands.
Yes,
and that was, you know, the three parts of that for sure. And I never thought of that. That's great. And for the larger culture, he understood that not everybody would accept Christian faith. He understood that there are whole gradations of people out there, and the lines, boundaries of not only Christian faith, but who would even be open to it. That's not a sharp line. And so to the larger culture, I think it would be a call to decency. Indeed, he would say that he had many Jewish friends, and he shared a great deal with them. In fact, one time he joked and he said, we share faith in God and country and morality and ethics, but he said that we do differ on the identity of the Messiah. He said there we differ, and that's a very important difference.
Yes, it is.
But I mean, his point was that even if you're not in the Christian fold, there is a great deal that we can share.
Yes.
About our lives as citizens of the nation and of the world. And I should also say the last third of his ministry, that is from the 70s, 80s, and 90s, He looked very systematically toward international his meetings. I'm not certain of this, but I'm quite sure that at least half or more of his meetings in the last third of his life were outside the United States and Canada. And there he was very intentional that the gospel is global. And we have a message for the entire world.
It's not singular focused on one country.
It's not one country, that's for sure.
And I think he was right. One last word. So what, how did he speak into Grant Wacker?
A model that I'd like to emulate. Not totally. Yeah. I mean, there's nobody who's perfect.
No.
But in many ways, I would like to emulate the character. There's no trace of personal immorality in terms of a violation of his marriage vows or financial integrity. There's no trace. And boy, reporters have looked for it. Yeah. And there's absolutely nothing there. And I'd like to emulate the uprightness of the character and the humility.
Yeah.
And now, you know, these are very high standards for the rest of us. And then the depth and integrity of his Christian faith.
And I mean, passion.
Passion, and it didn't waver. There were mistakes. Mistakes are plenty, here and there.
Yeah.
And he was the first to say so. So the last time my wife were there, Catherine and I were there, he greeted us, and he said, what brings you into the neighborhood?
That brings you into the neighborhood, like you just walked off the street.
And then as we were leaving an hour or two later, he said, well, next time you're in the neighborhood, be sure to drop by. And I think that was absolutely genuine. He did not have a sense. Yeah, but, you know.
What it took.
Of what that took us.
Yeah,
you know,
he had no clue about that.
No, you know. Yeah, and so, I mean, that's the humility, the ordinariness of...
So, Grant, if you will, what, as you've studied this man and as you've been a disciple yourself, you've been United Methodist for a very long time.
Mm-hmm.
So what, Grant, would you say that he would speak, Billy would speak, knowing this volume, and knowing we can't speak for him, mm-hmm. but what is your gut that he'd speak into our culture, into our world, into American Christianity today?
I think he would say, for all who have ears to hear, come to faith in Christ. And he would not always define it in the way people would think, as, you know, 1 minute you're in, you're on the bus, and 1 minute you're off the bus, the next minute you're on the bus. That was part of it, for sure. Sometimes that's the appropriate response.
Yes.
But more often he would say, make a decision.
That's the starting place.
And note that his radio and TV programs are both called Hour of Decision. His magazine was called Decision. Make a decision. And I think what the heart of that is shoulder your responsibility before God and yourself and commit to walk in the faith, to walk in love, to walk with Christ, to, insofar as we're able to be like Christ, and to give your life and your love, is that your priority? Make a decision, come to faith, and live that way thereafter.
Last night, I preached on John 3:16, and the people here set it all together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And last night, more than 1,700 people came and made their commitment to Christ. The man looked at that same verse, and the counselor told him, you can put your name in that verse. You are the whosoever. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, put your name there, whosoever believeth or commit his life to him will never perish but have everlasting life. And then he had a grin on his face and he said, I like that. You can put your name tonight in that same way as all of those did last night. God so loved the world for you that he gave his son, and you put your name and say, Lord, I open my heart and my life to you. I commit myself to you. For some of you, it may be that you're going to recommit your life. For others, you're going to make a brand new start. You want to be sure how you stand before God tonight. You must make the decision about Christ yourself. Our reaction to loneliness is often to deal with the symptoms rather than the cause. We get involved in pleasures, parties, good times, sex. We get involved in our work. We throw ourselves into the social whirl at the school. We read one of the best-selling books, which urges us to take control of our lives. But you have to make this decision alone. If we search for an antidote to loneliness and drugs and alcohol and sex and encounter groups and psychological experiences, often it only serves to mire us deeper in despair without a remedy. Through Jesus Christ, we can have the most fundamental relationship in life restored. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. The psalmist that wrote that about the pelican and the owl said, oh, my soul, why be so gloomy and discouraged? Trust in God. I shall again praise him for his wondrous help. He will make me smile again, for he is my God. Loneliness is often God's way of letting us know it is time to reach out. Reach out to the cross. And you'll never be lonely again.
But I'm not a traveling salesman. No, I'm not the Kirby man. I'm not raffling off tickets. And I don't work for Uncle Sam. I'm not a Jehovah's Witness. I'm on a missionary. I'm not offering quick fixes. A home remedy. There's no sense of grief that I cannot forgive. No sinner who cannot look to me and live. No brokenness that I cannot heal. No emptiness that I cannot feel. No, I'm not a traveling salesman. No, I'm not the Kirby man. Here to sell you Avon, and I don't work for Uncle Sam. I'm not a Jehovah's Witness, a Mormon missionary. I'm not here to prey upon your sense of charity. I came because my father sent me. I came because you need me. I'm standing at your door, and I am
Graham would have sat down in his living room and had this conversation about this amazing invitation that is always available to you through Jesus Christ. This opportunity to make a decision based on not your worthiness, but that you were created in the image of God to reflect God's love in the world. So apart from theology and denomination, apart from stage and scenery and the beautiful voice of Beverly O'Shea, God is inviting you to make a decision. Whether you are in the best part of your life or in the worst part of your life, Jesus is saying, you need me. I fulfill the reason you've been created. That invitation doesn't stop. But man, real life begins when you accept that invitation and make a decision. The kind of life that you were meant to live. That's what you're being invited to. You're not being invited to fill a pew or to log on at a certain time and watch worship. You're invited to say yes when Jesus says, follow me. So make a decision. Say yes and follow Jesus. Thank you for worshiping this week at White Plains.
Be with us, and just as we've drawn near to you, Lord, although we pray that out of your grace and mercy, you would draw near to us this day. Bless your holy name.
You know, those sorts of things.
Oh, that's good.
You know,
ooh,
yeah.
So, see, he's even smarter than he looks.
That's actually true.
Well, that is saying very little. Matter of fact, you know,
the
long on low. So he ought to be okay.
I had one friend say that too, and he said, boy, I hope so.
Yeah, that's my feeling. Well, I hope so. It's not saying much.